שלום, צהריים טוב לכם. הכנס
נפתח
תחת הכותרת
This conference is entitled Changing the Rules of the Game. And I want to say that in many ways the game has changed. When you look at what happens in the northern part of Israel, in Lebanon and Syria, and also the east, there is a multi-layered aspect. There are terrorist organizations and countries, and they are all bound together against one organization. And I think that the connection between our friends and our rivals against one entity, which is IS, that poses a big challenge and also a big risk to us. But before we talk about that, let me talk a little bit about the basic conditions we have here in this area, in this region, that have not changed. And we'll begin with a series of points. None of them are defense to the per se, but they all together put together a long picture. We're going to have 8 million Jews and 8 million non-Jews in this region in the next few years. And from that point on, we as the Jewish people will become a minority in this region for the first time after 9 years. The second thing is income per capita in Israel is more than $40,000. In the Gaza Strip, it is less than $2,000. In Syria today, the civil situation, and in many other places around us. Which means that an Israeli citizen who looks a kilometer away from Shdod to Beit Hanun sees someone who makes 3 or 4% of the wages they do, and around the world that's a sufficient reason for war. Here it's just the verbs in the Middle Eastern boiling pot. Water. There's enough water, but it's sometimes a reason for conflict. And while we are fighting over a well here or there, as we did a decade ago, at the same time, hundreds of thousands of cubic meters of water are being spilled into the sea from other rivers. So it's not a real problem. It can be financially resolved, but it is always a catalyst. The fourth thing that the world is seeing well, and we are feeling for many years, decades in fact, is that we are at the center of the Muslim world, some of which is hostile. If you zoom out on the map and see what color it has from west to east, from the shores of Africa, Morocco, Tunisia, Algiers, Libya, Egypt, there is a tiny spot with a different color called Israel, and even Iran, Jordan, Iran, Iraq, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and so forth. I'm not saying that whoever is the color of Islam is our enemy, but we must remember that extreme Islam is rising and growing in these areas and is trying to test our patience in the Western world and also in the and the final point that we're all aware of, and I'm sure that in this conference you have talked about it, is nuclear. When we talk about nuclear, naturally, here we talk about Iran, but I want to remind you that 35 years ago, Israel attacked a reactor in Iraq, and a decade ago, some say that we attacked a reactor in Syria, and Libya was also on its way, and Iran is doing what it's doing, and we're not talking anymore about further or more remote places. Unfortunately, that's just a fact. That is the platform that we are living on, and it's going somewhere. And you have to remember that our ability to impact these things is quite small, and we have to navigate our way through it. And now let's go back to the north. What began 5 years ago as a local battle, in many respects, between us and the Junior's regime, and rebels became quite quickly a conflict, a struggle, where Iran and Hezbollah and its Alawite ally, Syria's Assad Syria, are going against Jubhat al-Nusra, ISIS and others, and very rapidly this developed into a battle that is now of a different scale. It became one whereby the entire world is struggling one next to the other against this threat of ISIS. In the lower level we see Hezbollah, the next level we see traditional Syria, but right above it there are the regional countries, the regional states, and there is some collaboration against this common enemy. You find Turkey there, Egypt, or what it represents, Saudi Arabia and the Gulf countries, and also Iran. They are all on the same level against this one common enemy that poses a danger to them, whether they are Sunnis or Shiites, extreme or less so. Then there is the European level, and finally the superpower level of the United States and Russia. When I look at this, I see an insight. ISIS, Daesh, despite being very brutal and cruel, despite relying on being cruel and brutal to its population, in the areas that it controls, in Syria and Iraq, ultimately, its depth is limited. It does not have technological depth, it does not have a real economic depth like a country does, and at the end of the day, it will be defeated by the world. And when the world defeats ISIS, we will remain on our own, facing one danger, and that is the Iranian danger, the front of which, the one that we are in contact with, is Hezbollah. And as far as we are concerned, Hezbollah and Iran are one and the same. At the current stage of affairs, there is a process of fighting with one another. We are learning from one another, we are cooperating, collaborating, we're learning tactics, we're getting closer, and we're living in some sort of brotherhood that is designed to defeat Daesh. We will be able to defeat them. It will take a year or five. ISIS will not survive. But once this threat will be removed, and it will be removed, just like the Romans as an empire were able to defeat the pirates in Julius Caesar's time, the world too will be able to defeat ISIS. But then we will remain on our own with a vector at the end of which is Hezbollah, which is the operational arm of Iran, behind which is a technological, state-like, ideological, economic depth in the form of Iran. And this should not, you should not underestimate this. Iran has been attacking us for over a generation using various methods. First of all, we all know Hamas, Islamic Jihad, Hezbollah, as entities that create friction against Israel on its borders. No less than that is also recruiting people from the Gaza Strip and from the West Bank. We have terrorist attacks. We have seen them in the Middle East, in North Africa, in South America. They are all led and orchestrated by Iran. But this entire process is just to buy time. While the front lines, while that entity that goes forward and is battling with us with friction, as we see with Hamas and Hezbollah, the main entity called Iran is working in order to develop its capabilities, and these capabilities are technological, economic, and of course constantly striving towards nuclear capabilities. And a new reality whereby the gates of the world are opening up to Iran, and dozens of billions of dollars are expected to flow into the economy, creates a very big challenge for us. And I'm looking down the line 5 years, 10 years, and what should we do? Well, we need to be those who are struggling for attention, who look for a closer tie, closer connection with the world against this enemy called Iran and Hezbollah. If we ever find ourselves in a decade from now, so that Iran is being embraced by the Western world with our traditional allies, the United States, Western Europe, the Russians, whose ties with whom we have closer ties, this will pose great damage to Israel. And therefore, first of all, we need to have as many allies, as many friends, despite the common campaign that is now being conducted against Daesh. We need to remember well that our natural position is to be alongside the United States, alongside Europe, with the peace-seeking countries and the anti-terrorist countries, those who are in many ways liberal. The second thing is we must look at the region. We have an opportunity, and that is that the moderate Sunni world also views Hezbollah and Iran as Shiite factors, but moreover, the Sunni Salafist extremism, like Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and the rest, they see it as a danger. So let's get together with them. And I'm talking about those countries like Egypt and Jordan, with whom we already have ties, and countries with whom we have good ties as well, like the Gulf states. But we must not forget the Turks and others as well. All of these players are entities or factors that need to be together with us, whether in covert or overt alliances, because the depth behind Hezbollah in the form of Iran, a wealthy country, an advanced technological country with aspirations and a very extreme ideology, this process poses a very big challenge for us. And therefore, it is our duty, first of all, to remember that we need the strategic layer, Russia, the United States. Second of all, we need all of our friends on board, Europe and the free world. And finally, the region, and if possible, also other players as well. This process is crucial, and from here, let's go down one more level. As I've said, 8 million Jews and 8 million Palestinians are about to be living here within a decade, and from that moment on we will become a minority. It is our duty to make sure that the solution, the two-state solution, is realized here, which means that over the most of the area, most of the Jewish population is being controlled by the State of Israel, but the majority of the Palestinian population and the minority of the land will be controlled by the Palestinian Authority, without going into detail. This is a challenge and a goal for the State of Israel, much like it is for the Palestinians, and I don't want to go into the reasons right now, but if we look at our supreme interest, our interest is separation, because wherever there are two populations living alongside one another with different ideologies, with different worldviews, with different national and religious components, this brings about friction and tension. That brings about wars. It happened in the Balkan states, it happened in Asia, and now it's been happening for over 100 years. There is no way that one state, that these two populations, will give us a better reality. It will only give us a worse reality, and therefore we need the separation. And this separation will serve both the Palestinians and ourselves. In that respect, even if there are those who think that some things cannot be done right now, one thing can certainly be done right now, and that is to make sure that the economy on the other side, the Palestinian side, is improved. Because if the civil financial situation of the Palestinians is improved, it will have an impact on Israel's security. If 3 million people can provide for their families, can educate their children, their situation will be improved. If there will be millions there who cannot do that, this reality will ultimately give us a blowback. So when we talk about terrorism, terrorism needs to be fought against. You don't need to talk to me about that, because I did that 35 years in Lebanon, in Gaza, in Judea, in Samaria, and many other remote places. terrorists need to be hurt. If you be hurt by someone and you can kill them, otherwise arrest them and have them put on trial, and even with their families, if that needs to happen in order for the terrorists to take place. But whoever is not involved, take them and improve their life conditions, improve their income, improve their capabilities. And I would like to say one word about a headline in a few weeks ago. In Israel, there are almost 2 million Arab inhabitants living. They are Palestinian by origin, and they are not the enemy. They are citizens of Israel. They have equal rights and equal duties. And if we improve their situation, our situation as a Jewish population will improve, and our collective situation as citizens of Israel will improve. And therefore, facing the challenges in the northern part of Israel, we need to be very agile, very aware. We need to prepare militarily and prepare our intelligence. Third thing, we need to improve our relations and ties with all the relevant circles, on the upper layers, on the middle layers, and the bottom layers. And finally, to understand that we need to resolve the local conflict, which is the main cornerstone of the Arab-Israeli conflict. We have to start with resolving the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, and then we will still have an Arab population that is very vast in Israel, and the more its political, financial, cultural situation is improved, so it will be better for Israel and its Jewish citizens. Thank you very much.